Thank you very much for the introduction and thanks for inviting me, Lubos, to this interesting event. I just said earlier it is very important to talk about these issues, a social dimension of European integration, generally a social, the question of what happens to the crisis after, to the social dimension after the crisis. I apologize before I start for speaking in English to you. I could have offered German, but that won't be much help to most of you either. Maybe I learned Slovakian until next time, but for this time I have to, you have to do with English, and I hope I can help you with understanding what I'm saying by presenting this PowerPoint presentation. I've been asked to give some thoughts on what is happening to the social dimension of the European Union, the so-called European social model, particularly now after the global financial crisis and the ongoing Eurozone crisis. And here the question is, of course, did we ever have a European social model in the European Union? What is it actually, and what has happened to it now that we have the crisis? And this goes straight to the heart of what I would call the dilemma or the problem of the European integration process, and it's been talked about a bit this morning already. When we look at European integration in terms of the single European market, what used to be called the common market, what we started in the Treaty of Rome in 1957, we're very much looking at liberalization, deregulation, market liberalization, a consensus amongst all the countries in the European Union to say we abandon national rules, we deregulate, we privatize, we let the Commission tell us what the program for this is. But when it comes to developing common standards, for example, for employment rights, pension levels, taxation, anything that has to do, of course, with social and welfare standards, we have said we don't want this on the European level in Brussels. Let's keep this on the national level. So the vision we set out in the Treaty of Rome, or those that came before us set out in the Treaty of Rome in 1957, when we talked about an ever closer union between everybody in the European Union, the Slovaks, the Germans, the French, the Italians, and even the British, never really became a reality, because we all, and particularly some of the big countries, the United Kingdom is the best example, we always said, well, these are things that should be regulated on the national level. Let us not abandon any of these rights to the European Union or to Brussels. And this is why many academic scholars, most prominently Fritz Scharf, call the or characterize the process of European integration as one that is characterized by negative integration. Negative meaning we are removing all the national protection we have in the welfare state area. We let the Commission do that, but we do not actually create something new, no common standards. And the result we could see, of course, during the crisis, we had deregulated, we had privatized, we had removed barriers for financial industry to invest across Europe, but we haven't really looked at what is happening when we have a social crisis, like in Spain and in Greece and in Portugal. What is happening to these young people? Who will help them to find jobs, to find training, to make a living if their governments are not able to do so because they're essentially almost bankrupt? So this is the original dilemma that goes back to the Treaty of Rome, and then of course we see this continuing under the Lisbon Strategy, where by the end of the 1990s, after many attempts, particularly of the French government, to say maybe we can have common policies. Some of you will remember that in 1997, Lionel Jospin, the French Prime Minister, proposed a common European employment policy. He said maybe we should have a common European labor ministry that actually sets common standards, that this designs policies for the whole of Europe. It was vetoed by the UK, it was vetoed by Germany, and most other countries said this is not something we should do in Brussels. Let's keep this in Berlin, in London, in Paris, let's keep this in our national capitals. So there was always, and particularly since the 1990s, a lack of support for the harmonization of social policies. And the result of this was the development of a very strange mechanism which you will see I've highlighted in my presentation as in the title. The open method of coordination was initiated in the late 1990s, a mechanism where basically we said no harmonization, but let's look at each other. Let's see if the Slovaks are very good in creating jobs, then let's learn from their government and let's see if Germany and France and the UK can maybe adopt some of those practices if they have good training programs for young people or if they have a good schooling system or good universities. But let's not have a solution for everybody. Let's not have common policies that apply to everybody. So policy learning, what we call very technical best practice benchmarking, that means if one country is doing very well in doing something, other countries should look at it and should learn from it and should adopt these practices. But no binding harmonization. And as a result, of course, we had 27 countries with very, very different welfare state social models. And the Commission kept talking about a common European social model and said, here in Europe, we are very different from China, from Russia, from other parts of the world because we have welfare standards. But they actually ignored the fact that they were so different, and it was mentioned earlier today, some countries spend very little on welfare, had high poverty rates. Others also spent little but had much better results. Others, like Sweden, spent a lot, had high levels of taxation, and as a result, also very, very equal societies. But again, we could not say that we have a very standardized European social model. And the Commission realized this, and as a result, what did it do? Barroso, a relatively neoliberal free market reformer, a Commission president that was supported by Tony Blair. We all know what Tony Blair stood for, and by people like Bertie Ahern, the former Irish Prime Minister. He said the European social model should be about flexicurity, combination of flexibility, that means workers must take any job, including precarious employment. They must move to short-term employment. They must move around. If they don't find a job in Bratislava, then maybe they can work in Prague or in Warsaw or even in Berlin. They have to go where the job is. But at the same time, there has to be a minimum support provided by the state. Barroso always said, we're not like America. We still want to prevail with some, welfare standards. But in the end, it is up to the countries how high or how low these standards are. And this is an interesting quote. He said in 2005, when they relaunched, started the Lisbon strategy again, he said, our social model is essentially about helping people to climb up the productivity ladder. So the little worker climbs up this ladder towards productivity to serve, as was said today, the purpose of the business. And this shows very much, of course, a neoliberal approach. He said, we are not like the Americans, but very much the core of this social model the Commission was promoting was essentially what we always call the Washington Consensus, deregulating, privatizing, making the labor market more flexible by reducing security for workers. But even more importantly, and this is something the Commission and many member state governments in Europe do not want to be reminded of, more importantly, the European Union actively promoted what we now say was the biggest mistake that led to the crisis, the reckless lending practices that we saw in America, where people borrowed a lot more than they could actually afford to borrow, a lot more than they could ever pay back. And here you see in 2004, this was from the report by the expert group led by the former Dutch Prime Minister Wim Kok. They advocated, they said, in the European Union, we need to look towards the American example, and we need to have a system where access to credit for the individual consumer, for the purchase, for buying houses, should be easier. We are far too regulated. We should be more flexible here. So essentially, let's look at America, and let's do it like the Americans. And now they, of course, say, we never said this, we never wanted this, but this is a fact that this was behind this. And then the crisis came. And you can see a big disagreement between leaders. The German lady, Angela Merkel, was suddenly the dominant leader, and everybody looked towards her. But essentially, and this is what I argue in my recent book on the financial crisis, essentially these figures here, the numbers or the characters issued by the rating agencies, they are the ones that started to govern Europe. The leaders, including Merkel, were saying, how can we gain control over this situation where every day there's news about Greek credit rating going down, Portugal going down, Italy going down, other countries might follow. So this explains why suddenly, after some hesitation, we saw a lot of political initiative to do something to somehow calm the markets. And I think this is very significant, that the crisis has shown that politicians have actually started to lose control of a situation and are now in the process of starting to regain it gradually. And interestingly, after the crisis, the first result was that suddenly everything they had promoted before was wrong. Here they say in the re-evaluation of the Lisbon strategy in 2010, this is from the Commission, that the big mistake was to promote a situation where we would allow financial bubbles in the housing market to develop. Essentially, they admitted it was wrong to encourage people to borrow more than they could earn. And this, of course, led to problems in the UK, where the housing market crashed, in Ireland, where the housing market crashed and led to a complete collapse of the banking sector, and also in other countries like Spain, and the latest one we see, Slovenia. So this is obviously a big problem. So they admitted this, but at the same time, they said, we need to do something, we need to be more active, and Angela Merkel very hesitantly started to say, well, the markets are telling us where to go, so we need to react, we need to calm them. And they started looking at rectifying, basically making up the faults of the Eurozone, economic and monetary union, where monetary union, creating one single currency, was never accompanied by regulating or harmonizing budgetary policies. And this explains why so many countries were allowed to develop excessive deficits, but also we never actually looked at the overall macroeconomic policies of countries, and this also explains why we now have a situation of a country like Greece being completely uncompetitive. Nobody really cared about Greece going down a route where they didn't export anything, they relied basically on a housing bubble and on cheap credit, and this is of course was a big problem. And now we see, and this is my final point in the last 2 minutes, we see a frantic drive towards designing new policies, binding for everybody. The first one is this Europe 2020 strategy. We suddenly are confronted in Europe, all the member states, with a lot of targets. Suddenly we have to show that we can have 75% employment rate in all countries. We are supposed to have high levels of education and training, the high levels of research and development. And at the same time, the Commission says 2 million people by 2010 should be taken out of poverty in the whole of the EU. They don't tell us how we do it. They say somehow better education, better training, more accessible labor markets. And also we need to look at the environment. And as a result of this, they introduced this European semester where every year governments now have to show the Commission what is their agenda, their economic agenda, their budget agenda. So a lot more supervision of national governments, their freedom to introduce their own policies has been very limited. The countries that want to join the Eurozone that are still on the outside, including Poland and Romania and Bulgaria, Latvia, Lithuania, they are the ones that have voluntarily agreed to do even more, to say we answer to Mrs. Merkel and we answer every year and regularly in terms of all these issues here. How much employment do we create? How competitive are our economies? Are our budgets in order? So this Euro Plus Pact has linked the Euro outsiders with the Euro insiders. This was something Angela Merkel wanted. And the final point is this, what everybody talks about. And you can see here, she obviously, Mrs. Merkel has her guns and sticks by it. The fiscal compact, where 25 of the 27, now we have 28, countries, we still don't know what Croatia will do, have signed a compact where they say we implement in the budgets, in our national legal framework, in our constitution, the need to have a debt break. That means a government is not allowed to spend more than maximum 1% of its nominal GDP. And that means If a country has high unemployment or has social problems, it is now very, very limited in terms of what it can actually actively do to change the situation. There are limits to how much one can invest in the welfare state, in education, in training, in research and development. And this is my final point. If you look at the Europe 2020 targets, where we say 20 million people taken out of poverty, under the condition of a severe crisis, in some countries a severe budget crisis, how can we do this? How can we come to high employment rates, good levels of education, very, very good rates of research and development, when we at the same time say to governments, you are not allowed to spend more than a very, very low limit? And we see this already in Southern Europe. These countries are asking this question, how can we get out of our situation without being allowed to spend if we just have to implement austerity? And I think this is the legacy of the crisis that the European Union has left us, that is very, very difficult when it comes to creating a social model. Thank you very much.
Ďakujem pekne za príspevok Christiana Schweigera. Spomínal som novú dimenziu Európskej únie ako črtu, ktorá spája tento panel, na rozdiel od prvého panelu, a teraz mám pocit, že sme vlastne hovorili po tomto príspevku o tom istom, ako bola úvodná ako prednáška. Hej. A dostali sa k tomu, že projekt európskej integrácie bol pochopený ako projekt zavádzania voľného trhu, ako integrácie na spôsob ekonomickej slobody. Sociálne štandardy zostali v úrovni učenia sa na otvorených príkladoch dobrej praxe. Hej. A sme sa dostali do tej základnej témy, a to je zadlženosť štátov a dlhová služba, ktorá organizuje politické reakcie týchto štátov, dokonca aj na úrovni politického líderstva Európskej únie, až po tú konečnú dilemu, akým spôsobom v čase krízy naštartovať rast, ale zároveň aj rast, ktorý hovorí o zamestnanosti a o sociálnych ako štandardoch pre väčšinu, ktorá ho v čase krízy stratila, a nenáhodou sa tam objavila téma politiky šetrení a fiškálnej dohody, ktorú podpísala aj Slovenská republika o nemožnosti prekročenia dlhu 60% HDP. Stále hovoríme o tom, ako to nemôže ísť. Ja som veľmi zvedavý pre tých hrdinov, ktorí sa chopia myšlienky, čo a ako ďalej. Hej. Dovolím si možno v tomto očakávaní, pretože Ľuboša tu nevidím, hej, ale má byť teraz na programe dňa. Hej. Zrejme pochopil, že to nebude jednoduché, hej. Ale Ľuboš, dovolte, aby som uviedol tretieho hostia, pokiaľ sa vráti. Hej. Doktor Ľuboš Bláha vyštudoval politológiu a súčasne filozofiu na dvoch ako univerzitách v Bystrici a v Bratislave. Je známy predovšetkým tým, že myslím, že v slovenskej politologickej a filozofickej verejnosti uviedol témy teórie spravodlivosti, ktorú chápe v neomarxistickom kontexte. O tom bola jeho základná práca, ktorá sa stala, ak to môžem povedať, takým možno prvým vedeckým bestsellerom slovenskej odbornej tvorbe, späť k Marxovi aj s tým veľkým otáznikom, hoci tému bol John Rawls a jeho spôsob ľavicovej interpretácie. Ľuboš znova ako spája tie dve črty tohto panelu, že je zároveň aj politicky veľmi aktívnym človekom, je poslancom Národnej strany, zároveň je predsedom Výboru Národnej rady pre európske záležitosti. Ako som povedal, hovorí teraz po týchto dvoch príspevkoch ako človek, ktorý analyzuje a zároveň rozhoduje, nebude jednoduché, ale vidím, že Ľuboš vrátil tomuto panelu poriadok a vracia sa na svoje miesto. Poprosím ho, aby sa ujal svojho slova. Mimochodom, je to jeho iniciatíva, zrejme aj jeho nápad dať dnešné stretnutie, dnešnú konferenciu do tejto podoby, v akej sme tu dnes, a možno aj v tomto očakávaní chceme počuť, ako na to Ľuboš.